By 1975, Motown Records had moved from Detroit to Hollywood. That year, Teena Marie met Motown producer Hal Davis, who took her band's demo to the man at the top, Berry Gordy.
A lot of artists come in the company. They don't right away get to see Berry, but Hal took her immediately to Berry, and he liked her immediately. He saw something. I believe Teena came with a group as well, but Teena was singled out.
She came and she sung and she moved and she had so much soul, but we had no need for a group.
Motown was always a company that ran on hits, but producers there struggled to strike the right chord with Teena, much to the frustration of Berry Gordy.
She used to sit outside my office for many days, and many of those days she would cry.
The process is very tedious sometimes, and she went through several sessions with several producers.
But she was different. She was different than everyone we had. And I just thought she was just an incredible talent and all that. But we had so many great talents, so many great artists.
More than 2 years passed, and Teena hadn't released a single track. Fearing she'd be dropped from the label, Teena's manager, Winnie Martin, arranged to get her into a Motown band called Apollo that included two of Berry Gordy's sons and a 17-year-old Benny Medina.
We were young guys. We were a band trying to make a record, trying to figure out, you know, how to get the attention of all the power in the company.
We hadn't released a record. She hadn't released a record. We were still in artist development mode. We were trying to figure out, you know, our brand, what we were going to look like, what we were going to be.
When I would come to rehearsals, they would make up like counter lyrics to the songs, and the counter lyrics would be like really, really foul.
There's one girl in the band, okay, and we would change the lyrics to, you know, female body parts. Or
they made up this counter lyric going, "I wanna squeeze your titties, your titties." And I'm just sitting there and I'm looking around and I'm like, well, I'm the only girl here. I'm the only one, you know, that has breasts, right?
I didn't think that it really offended her until the one day that she was at the studio and we started getting into this song, right? And I guess we were singing about these female body parts and she says, oh, excuse me, listen, I'm gonna go to the store. I'll be right back.
And I got in my Vega and I drove from Burbank, one of those studios on Lancashire, all the way to Palm Springs. And I called home to Winnie and I said, if you don't get me out of this group, I said, I'm never coming back.
Teena was back to square one. Then Motown called on one of their hottest acts to lend a helping hand.
We needed something to break her. And Rick James was a different kind of guy who came in there. He was outrageous, ridiculous, and brilliant.
He was a great producer, he was a great songwriter, he was a great singer, and he had his own style.
I called him. Conversation with something like, Rick, is this great artist here, Teena Marie? Said, don't. I know what you're gonna say. I just wanna work on my own stuff. I said, Rick, let me do this. Would you mind if I send you a tape of her? Whatever.
I was in one of the piano rooms on the 17th floor. And one of these particular days, Rick put his head in the door and he started listening to me. I thought he was really funny looking, and he only had, his hair was half braided, and he had on this Jimi Hendrix hat and high platform shoes with all this turquoise jewelry that later turned into diamonds. But in the early days, it was turquoise. And we just started talking.
He happened to come in the office one day. We were talking about something. When he was about to exit the office, he turned and he said, oh, by the way, I'm gonna do something with that little girl. I said, what little girl? You know, by then I'm, you know, doing something else. He said, the little white girl.
We went into the studio and I think I really, really knew when he started sending me some music. It was music that he wrote, but it had elements of me in it.
With James writing and producing many of the songs, Teena Marie recorded her debut album for Motown in 1979, 3 years after she signed with the label. It was titled Wild and Peaceful, and Tina's face was notably absent from the cover.
Mr. Gordy settled on a beautiful seascape. He decided that it would be a great idea for people to just hear the music on its own merit before they judged what the person looked like.
People associated a book with its cover so many times. So I could see that being a very good reason why.
So they brought out the voice before they brought out the record. And people love the voice.
Baby, you two are a mellow fellow. And you're as rare as vintage wine. I'll take you any place.
James wrote the lead single, I'm a Sucker for Your Love, a duet with Teena that hit number 8 on the Black Singles charts. Then he joined her on stage for Teena's national TV debut on Soul Train.
I'm just a sucker for love, sucker for love, sucker for love, baby.
As far as Motown was concerned, we had no other acts that had the street credibility that Rick had. So pairing him with anyone at that specific time in his career was gonna give that person at least street credibility.
We just had something, you know, we had that magical thing. The timbres of our voice, it just became something really, really wonderful and beautiful. I really think it's a God-given gift.
Teena's debut duet was the beginning of a musical kinship that would deepen and intensify over time, on stage and off.
My mother used to say, why don't you marry him? He's rich. I was like, he'd be the last person you would ever want your daughter to marry if you really knew who he was, Ma.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. I don't have time for babies, no, no. And it's hard, hard to keep a man. But I tell you one thing that I'm gonna do. I'll have my cake and eat it too. If your patience doesn't get the best of you, one day I'm gonna have my cake, my love. And you.
I got to pick a song for my first album when Rick was producing the album. And I thought that would be a good one because it really, really talked about where I wanted to be. I'm gonna have my cake and eat it too. I thought that was a good choice because I knew one day that I was gonna write and produce my own songs.
But not quite yet. To produce Teena's second album, Motown executive Don Ellis hired veteran producer and songwriter Richard Rudolph.
In truth, I think it was really to give her confidence to go on to see that she could do it all herself. Don's thinking was she didn't need necessarily a dominant personality. I mean, Rick's so great, and they were a great team. But Teena had a lot of stuff to say, and maybe he just wanted to give her room to say it herself.
The album was titled Lady T, after the nickname Rick James had given Teena. Released in 1980, it featured instant R&B classics like Aladdin's Lamp, Now That I Have You, and Behind the Groove.
Wild and Peaceful, because it was produced by Rick James, was a lot more raw, because it was really funky and rootsy, even the pretty music. The Lady T album that Richard produced was more polished, a little more glamorous.
This girl's got it all. She, you know, she needs me like she needs another hole in the head. Because Teena really, you know, she was on the path. She was going to get there one way or another. You know, maybe I kept saying, you don't need me, baby. You got, you know, you got this here.
For her next record, Irons in the Fire, Teena took over the reins, writing, producing, arranging, even hiring new band members with an offer they couldn't refuse.
She said, you guys help me make hit records, you know, you have jobs for life.
She's a woman who produces her own records, which is extremely rare. It was extremely rare in the 80s.
We did our best, and we dug deep into our souls, our hearts, and came up with music that sounds way beyond 21 and 22-year-olds.
Irons in the Fire was released in 1980 and became her first LP to crack the R&B top 10. At the same time, Tina's mentor, Rick James, was busy putting the finishing touches on his new album, titled Street Songs.
Just Street Songs came along and it just changed the ballgame. That record made them reassess what they were doing in Motown, and rightly so.
For its soulful centerpiece, Rick called on Tina. Their lives would never be the same.
That's power. It's love power. And both of them were powerful on it.
The fights on stage were just crazy. He would always make this crack, I'm Rick M.F. James. And I was Teena M.F. Marie.
What was it like being a white girl among so many stars, legendary stars like Diana Ross and Stevie Wonder and Marvin?
It's devastating. When I met Diana Ross, I was devastated. You know, a dream.
Did you relate?